Mr. Clerk, are we prepared to proceed? I think we have all councillors in attendance.
We do, Mr. Mayor. We're streaming live and ready to go.
Okay, thank you. Then I'd like to open the committee the whole at whatever time it is, 10 after, and call to order. First thing we'll do is disclosure of pecuniary interest, the nature thereof, direct or indirect, for committee members. Councillor Carr.
I'd like to remove myself from the discussion on patio extension, please.
Duly noted, and I think the clerk will take note of that. Thank you very much. Is there anything else from anybody, any other committee member? Not seeing any. Thank you. Delegations, we do not have any tonight. The consent agenda, item 4. Items listed under the consent agenda are considered routine in nature and are considered collectively as one motion. Council members may request that specific items be removed for further separate discussion, deliberation, or action. We have 4.1, 4.2. Does any committee member wish to pull either of these out for further discussion? Not seeing any, I'll proceed. 4.1, Police Services Board Meeting Minutes of January 27, 2022. 4.2, the Joint Animal Control Municipal Services Board Meeting Minutes of February the 23rd, 2022. I would like a mover to receive for information. Councillor Meadows, second by Councillor Carr. All those in favor? That's carried unanimously. As noted earlier in the council meeting, Councillor Lees is not available tonight, so I'll take this next committee, and it's Corporate Services. 5.1 Staff Reports, 5.1.1 Report CS0322, Use of Corporate Resources for Election Purposes. And I would ask if Shmiza is on the line. Shmiza, are you there? And would you like to just perhaps make a comment on this report?
Hello, good evening, Mr. Chair, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to this report. My apologies for the technical issues, and I'm glad that they got fixed and we have some attendees today. So as you know, the 2022 municipal election is a few months away, and the Office of the Clerk has been working hard to ensure that we are meeting our legislative obligations. We're also ensuring that our policies and our procedures are up to date. Section 88.18 of the Municipal Election Act does require that before May 1st of the year of a regular election, municipalities shall establish rules and procedure with respect to the use of municipal resources during the election campaign period. As such, today, staff are bringing forward a policy for council approval, which identifies the parameters for the proper use of municipal resources during an election for which a candidate has filed a nomination. The policy that you have in front of you will replace the previous use of corporate resources policy, bylaw 09-2010, which was last updated over a decade ago. And it does not account for the advances with respect to technology, the use of technology, use of social media, meeting platforms, etc. The proposed policy that you have in front of you also further defines staff obligations and ensures that the roles and responsibilities of candidates and municipal staff are laid out clearly. Adoption of the policy is going to help ensure that the Municipality of Port Hope upholds the provisions of the Municipal Elections Act, and it will also assist the returning officer, Brian Gilmer, in carrying out his obligations with respect to an accountable and transparent election. So I'm available here for any questions, should you have them.
That was a great summary. Thank you very much, Rijma. I'm going to open up any questions from councillors at this point or committee members at this point. In that case, I'm going to move forward that a resolution be presented to council to adopt the proposed use of corporate resources for election purposes policy, and that a bylaw be presented to council to repeal bylaw 09/2010. I'd like a mover. Moved by Councillor Meadows, second by Councillor Bickel. All those in favor? Thank you. And we also have 5.1.2 report CS0422 regarding emergency purchase, and that's the SAN server equipment. And we're going to receive this for information, and our clerk would just probably give us a little summary on that.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. That is it's a purchase we move forward with in an emergency manner under our procurement bylaw as determined by me, the director, responsible this time around. It is a purchase that was budgeted and included in the budget for 2022. You'll note in the report that we are under budget. We just simply weren't in a position to follow the regular steps associated with our procurement policy after we had issues identified that pretty much mandated our expedition of the purchase. So we were able to negotiate directly with manufacturers to speed up our time for that product to arrive. And we expect that to arrive soon, and we'll make the necessary technical changes to put ourselves back in a stable position. We don't believe there's any associated risk at the moment, but we did believe it's important that we move forward with that purchase as soon as possible. And as required by our procurement bylaw, in those situations, which are few and far between, we have to provide a report to council at the following meeting, and that's what you have before you. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. I think you did really well in a tight situation. And I think we all are aware, you know, the delays that have occurred in the last probably year or two. So well done, and thank you for looking after things. I'm going to open it up to Councillor Carr or committee member Carr.
Yes, I'd just like to commend corporate services and the IT team for taking decisive action on that, because you know, it's very critical having the SAN server operational, and being able to do that quickly and on budget was really well done.
Thank you for those comments. I think we all concur with that. Any other committee member wish to make a comment or a question? Then I'd like a mover to receive for information, please. Councillor Carr, seconder. Councillor Bickle, all those in favor? Thank you, and thank you again for the proactive nature of getting that fixed. 5.2 is new business. I don't have any. And with that, I'm going to move it over to Councillor Carr.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Finance is open. 6.1, staff reports. There are none. 6.2, new business. I'll provide the library update. The Port Hope Public Library will be conducting a service delivery review, including but not limited to an assessment of hours of service, collections, programming, technology, and marketing. Recommendations of this review are expected to identify opportunities for directed growth and development that will guide the library in its long-range strategic plans. The RFP for this project can be found on the library website, porthopepubliclibrary.ca, or at porthope.ca/business-and-development/bid-opportunities. And printed copies can be available as well by contacting Margaret Scott, CEO. The Library Book Club is meeting Tuesday, March 22nd at 1 p.m. This month's selection is Any Book by John Grisham. Email ahouston@phpl.ca to register, and masks will be mandatory. In partnership with Early On Northumberland, there will be programs based on interactive play for babies to 6-year-olds at the Mary J. Benson branch. Pre-register at cindy.marshall@nrt.ymca.ca. The dates are March 23rd and the 30th, and the programs run from 10:30 to 11:30. PHPL is hosting a special writers group facilitated by Samantha McDonald on Saturday, March 26th from 10 a.m. to noon. Pre-registration loleary@phpl.ca. Again, masks are required. And don't miss a special 3-day fundraising event sponsored by the library's Friends of the Library. Preview pre-owned costume jewelry 2 weeks in advance of the March 31st, April 1st, April 2nd sale at the Mary J. Benson Branch. And if there's no questions for finance, that's it for finance tonight, and I'll turn it over to the Deputy Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Carr. Planning and development is open. Staff reports 7.1. Report PD 0822. Re sidewalk patio program bylaw amendments. 1, that a resolution be presented to Council to provide an exemption as per the authority to change the operating season for the sidewalk patio extension licensing program from starting May 1st, 2022, and bringing it forward to April 6th, 2022, and that staff be directed to prepare the bylaw amendments necessary to delegate to staff the authority to provide such exemptions to the sidewalk patio program moving forward. I have a mover and a seconder, please. Moved by Councillor Meadows, seconded by Councillor Bickle. Questions? Councillor Meadows.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. I just had a comment. I just wanted to say I think it's great forward thinking to allow the establishments to get into action earlier, especially with the Float Your Fanny Down the Ganny resuming again this year, and that enables them to participate in the event. So thanks very much for bringing that forward.
Thank you. Director Davis, did you have any comments?
Through you, Deputy Mayor Andrews, not necessarily. We wanted to bring forward this motion so that we could capture the sort of early return of Float Your Fanny Down the Ganny and the sort of reopening of the local economy a little bit with some of the changes. And we also wanted to recognize that the restaurant community in particular has been hard hit through this pandemic. And so we wanted to sort of be able to give them an opportunity to reopen earlier if that was allowed. And so we thank councils for considering this tonight.
Thank you. And well, does this apply to maybe moving the outdoor patios in front of the participating restaurants to April 6th? The patios that are installed on the roads and the parking spaces, will they be in place for that time period?
Provided that council, back to the Deputy Mayor, provided that council endorses this evening and ratifies it on April 5th, as of April 6th, they will be available to do so. Our goal is to have there are three patios in question, frankly, on that are impacted by this. And our hope is to have, expectation would be to have them up and running or operational for the weekend, that weekend, April 9th.
Perfect. Thank you. Any, Mayor Sanderson?
Just a comment, does that use of municipal property for other patio purposes, such as, you know, by Lent Lane and what have you, is this included in their ability to use that property for their business purposes as well?
Through the Deputy Mayor, back to Mayor Sanderson, I believe that because it's a public space, but it does not impact traffic. We do not get involved. We allow that space to be opened up a little bit, as far as I understand in past practice, but that does not require or has not previously required an application process because it doesn't involve or have an impact on parking or the road.
Yeah, I understand. And the patios that we provide, you know, are on the streets. I just want to make sure that as we move forward, that there is the opportunity for, you know, those other places to use municipal property, you know, officially, I guess. And I'm not sure exactly how that has moved forward or what is necessary, if it's just a notification or an approval purpose. But I would like to make sure that we're helping all the businesses that we can.
Absolutely.
As a side note, maybe it would be worthwhile putting up on our website the current LCBO liquor licensing laws and what is permitted and what isn't permitted. I'm a little hazy on it all myself, but what's permitted outdoors and in parks, etc. Just a suggestion.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. I'll confer with the communications department and see how we might communicate that, better communicate that to the businesses, for sure.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? All those in favor? And that's unanimous. That's carried. And I have no new business tonight. Is there any new business of council? Any questions of planning and development? Seeing none, I'll turn it over to Councillor Meadows.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Andrews. And Parks, Recreation and Culture is open. 8.1 staff reports. I have none this evening. 8.2 new business. I do have a few things I'd like to update you on. First of all, the Float Your Fanny Down the Ganny event is returning this year, as just discussed, and this will be the 40th annual event after a two-year hiatus. The event is scheduled for April 9th, 2022. Registration is open for participants in all categories, canoes, kayaks, and crazy crafts. Also, volunteers are needed in multiple areas. You can register to be a participant or a volunteer online at www.floatyourfanny.ca. So please do look into that. We're also excited to see this port-up tradition return to the riverbank, and we look forward to connecting with friends, neighbors, and visitors throughout town. So please enjoy that celebration and be there and be safe. Also, we have staff and members of the Waterfront and Riverwalk Working Group invite the public to join us to learn about the development of the Waterfront and Riverwalk Master Plan. Have your say about opportunities for development and important considerations. Your feedback will help guide development of design concepts for the areas along the river, beaches, trails, center pier, and more. A number of formats are available for you to participate, including workshops, talk shops, and coffee shops. Full details are available at www.myporthope.ca/waterfront. Also, watch for details for the public design workshop coming later in April. Thank you. And that is all the new business that I have. Are there any questions or comments from council? Yes, Mayor Sanderson.
Just want to comment on the last bit you're talking about with the workshops, talk shops, and coffee shops. I really want to commend, you know, staff for moving that forward. It's quite an undertaking. I'm not aware that we've done this sort of proactive go to the community in the past. And I think we should applaud staff for doing that. Public input doesn't always come to us. I think you get the interaction and the walking and the coffee and maybe a beer, who knows, you know, then I think that we'll get a lot more feedback. And this is such an important area. And so it's kind of novel. And I just want to point out that, you know, participation, go and have some fun with the participation. That's what I think they've done. Just kudos to them.
Agreed. Thank you, Mayor Sanderson. Any other comments? Seeing none, then Parks, Recreation, and Culture is closed, and I will pass it off to Works and Engineering and Councillor Mink.
Thank you. Works and Engineering is open. 9.1 staff reports. 9.1.1 report WE-05-22 Re-Choate Street extension cancellation. The recommendation, one, that a bylaw be presented to council to enter into a termination of road construction agreement with Cameco Corporation and Cameco Property Holdings Incorporated, and further, that a bylaw be presented to council to enter into a purchase of sale agreement with Cameco Corporation and Cameco Property Holdings Incorporated, and further, that a bylaw be presented to council to enter into a restrictive covenant agreement with Cameco Corporation and Cameco Property Holdings Incorporated. Could I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by the mayor, seconded by the deputy mayor, and I will ask Director Davidson if she could speak to this for a few minutes.
Thank you, Councillor Mink. I would like to take a few minutes to share my screen and provide a little bit of a recap. So in August 2020, Cameco presented the proposed changes to the Vision in Motion project. The original proposal included the transfer of Marsh Street and Eldorado Place, as well as the former Waterworks East property to Cameco. Cameco was to build the extension of Choate Street to continue to provide access to the waterfront. The revised proposal eliminates the extension of Choate Street as Marsh Street and Eldorado Place remain municipal roads. A portion of the Waterworks East property has been identified as surplus as a result of the change, while a portion that includes the garage will remain under Cameco ownership. The initial proposal was the transfer of 0.8 acres of land highlighted in yellow. Through negotiations with Cameco, an additional 0.2 acres of land has been added to the proposed transfer highlighted in blue for a total of 1 acre of land. The initial proposal, now the majority of the property has been remediated as part of the PHAI. However, the existing water reservoirs remain on the property, and a special circumstance has been applied to this property as some LLRW still remains around the base of the tanks. Therefore, there are constraints with this property and the restrictive covenant does not impact the ability to use the space as active parkland in the future. Ongoing discussions are occurring between Port Hope and Cameco with respect to the replacement of water main on Marsh Street in Eldorado and the installation of a backflow device in the existing garage to protect the municipal drinking water system to be funded by Cameco. We are also looking at options to improve stormwater management and improve water quality by installing oil grit separators on Eldorado Place. The proposed agreements this evening moves forward and finalizes the termination of the Choate Street extension, which will allow the waterfront planning discussions to continue as part of the waterfront master planning work. I would be happy to answer any questions.
Do you want to take your share down so we can?
Yep. Yes, I could just see everybody. Thank you very much. So I will open that up to discussion. Anybody from council have any questions or comments? Mayor Andrews.
Yeah, first of all, are we getting all the land that we sold them back or traded them back? It appears we are.
No, we are not. The entire Waterworks East property was transferred to Cameco at the time, and we are only receiving the southern half back.
Okay, and the second then, why all the restrictive covenants? They seem overbearing in terms of allowing 30 people max on the site. I don't understand I guess I can understand that they don't want any vibrations or massive amounts, but typically parklands don't participate in that type of thing. So I just don't understand what they're trying to accomplish.
Well, it's for clarification, it's a maximum of seating capacity for 30. So we can't have more picnic tables or tables, as an example, that would allow for seating for more than 30 people. If there are over 30 people that would come down with lawn chairs and towels to watch the fireworks as a Canada Day festivity, as an example, there is no restriction for the number of people on that property. It's how many physical seats there would be installed as by the municipality on that property.
Why would that be a factor? What are they worried about?
They are a licensed nuclear facility, and they're worried about a sensitive use immediately adjacent to their property.
I'm sorry, they're worried about what?
It's a licensed nuclear industry, and they are worried about a sensitive use, which is parkland, immediately adjacent to their facility.
Any other questions from the deputy mayor? Sorry.
I don't understand. So there will be residents that will be using it as parkland, and they're concerned about that. I don't understand why.
They are concerned with uses that would be more than passive uses. So, you know, splash pads, washrooms, something that you build as an example is what they have a concern with. There is no concern with just passive parkland use for trails, you know, picnics, benches, picnic tables. Those are all permitted uses.
And if we say no?
This has been a negotiating, has been negotiated for well over a year. And you know, if that is council's prerogative to say no, we can take that back to CAMCO.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I think Councillor Meadows.
Sorry, yes, just in with keeping on the same conversation with the Deputy Mayor here. I would think if we are getting back only half the land that we traded to them, that we should have no restrictions on what we and our own land would like to do or not do with it in the future. So I agree with his concerns with that. And you know, and I understand the trouble you've gone through and the hard work that you've come to achieve this goal, Director Davidson, and I don't mean to discount that in any way, but by saying that it's been negotiated for a year, we negotiated the last Ring Road one for much longer than that with legal agreements, and that never came to fruition. So we are in the driver's seat on this one, and I really don't agree with the restrictions being put on the piece of land that we are getting back.
So regardless of the restrictive covenant, there is a constraint with the property as a result of the special circumstance in the LRW that is remaining on the property.
True, I do understand that. Thank you.
Thank you, and Councillor Carr.
Why is it that we're only getting half of the property back?
Well, the original vision in motion showed that this parcel would have been used for cylinder storage. CAMCO has modified their operations so that way the cylinder storage is no longer required, but they have identified that a portion of their land would still be required for their operations.
Do we know for what?
Part of the ongoing discussions with CAMCO are related to the water main. They do plan on replacing a section of the water main on Marsh Road in El Dorado at their cost and installing a backflow preventer within the garage, which would make that a private water service going forward. And I know they do plan, hope to expand some of their parking as well.
Thank you.
And are there any other questions? Comments, and Mayor Sanderson.
Just a couple of comments. First off, I do know how hard these negotiations have been in the past leading up to Choate Road and then getting rid of Choate Road, and they are very complicated. CAMCO does have its own reasons. I don't know obviously every one of them, but I also kind of look at the bigger picture saying we were going to have a road that many people in the public didn't like, was going to have a lot of involvement, did have a lot of involvement, property changes or whatever. And to me, this seems like a good outcome that that road is not being built. And I'm speaking on behalf of the municipality, but also on the residents and people who were very concerned. So I am a little bit, well, first off, you know, kudos for all the negotiations. I know how much time it takes and having, you know, been through it a few times already. But bringing this forward, I interpret it as you have negotiated on behalf of the municipality very hard. And this is, you know, a positive outcome that you've come forward and recommended that council, you know, accept. And if I look at it from, say, several years ago, when we were also supporting, you know, somewhat reluctantly in many cases, the extension of Choate Road. And we knew the infrastructure complications and the you know, requirements of that road, that this, independent of some of the details, you know, it does seem to me that this is a good step forward, I think, for those people who are concerned about the beaches and what have you. And so just to reiterate, what would your opinion be if council failed to accept the proposals that you're bringing forward? Would you feel we'd still be in a negotiation stage? And I know it's a hard opinion because it's opinion, right, to comment on, but obviously there are some concerns from council and the public that's been expressed about, well, okay, we sold them that land and they didn't need it for now for the road. Why are we getting half? And I think as the deputy mayor also said, why are there restrictive covenants? I think I understand the restrictive covenants much better in that I think they are sensitive to what's next door, to a facility such as this. And that does put some on them. I don't think they're overly restrictive, but by the same token, they are restrictive. So the outcome overall seems like a good one to me. And some of the details I think are being challenged because we haven't been involved in those negotiations as a council, and it's kind of, the public has raised a few questions and I think we're following up on that. So I'll turn it back to you if you kind of want to make any comments on that.
And Director Davidson, did you have any comment to make about that?
I don't know.
Okay. CAO Smith.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair Mick. I just wanted to comment that I've read the restrictive covenants, and although they sound very restrictive, but when you look at the property that we have, so number one is we won't build any specific structure there. So when we look at the available space of that land, it's really just restricting us in one small piece of that. It's an acre of that. And the amount of benches is a restriction. It's no more than 30. When I think about that, when I think about any other park, do we have more than 30 seating spots? Unless it's a picnic pavilion, we don't typically do that. Right, that's the restriction. Cameco has reasons. They're a good partner to us. We spent over a year negotiating that. The decision point that I would consider is more than 30 seating. Would we ever do that anyways? And maybe in some case we would, but probably not. Our directors have reviewed that and think it's a reasonable covenant. Would no covenant be perfect? Yes, but we need both parties to come to an agreement. So I think I would echo, some of the things that I'm hearing. This advances something. It allows the waterfront and Riverwalk to advance. There's other components to the PHAI project that can advance. And the risk is that if we say, hey, we want more than 30 seats there, which we probably wouldn't ever do, it could delay all of these other things multiple years.
Thank you. And Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Sorry, hitting the wrong buttons here. I'm not terribly concerned about the 30 seats or the 30 picnic benches and what that entails. But I am more concerned that why don't we take all the land back and give Cameco a 20 or 25 year lease on the property. And if they do something, then we get the chance to at least review it. And if they no longer exist in Port Hope or don't need that land, then it reverts back to parkland. And so it's more under our control than theirs.
And is that a question that you are asking, or are you making a motion to send something back?
Well, if I have to, I can make that motion, but it's a question at this stage that I'd like to see other councillors jump in on.
I have a different thought and question, not to distract from yours, but we have the Waterfront and Riverwalk Group. We have the GRCA who has made recommendations. We just had last year our recreation and service leisure plan, and we had a survey that went out. So I'm curious as to how is all this other activity that we're working towards, how is it aligned with this agreement that we have made? And if we do go back to the drawing board and renegotiate, will it put a halt on all of that activity that's currently underway, and what will those impacts be? And Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Yeah, to the best of my knowledge, Mayor Sanders and I sit on the Riverwalk Working Group, and we haven't been party to these discussions, or I don't see any impact at this point in time to slow us down. But I'd sure rather have the land than not have it.
And I just saw Julia, Director Snook, pop up. So perhaps did you have anything to add as far as from a recreational survey or any feedback as far as that goes? Director Snook.
Yes, through you, Councillor Mink, through the chair. From a recreation standpoint, the leisure services master walk master planning process, and the lands that we are speaking of have been identified as a connectivity point and potential expansion for some considerations to the West Beach planning. So related to the timeline, I mean, I can't speak to the specifics if they will be delayed, but we are in the midst of being able to present a master plan this year from waterfront and Riverwalk standpoint. There are obviously some longer term impacts that will be identified in that plan for the actual work to take place on those sites. But from a leisure services master plan, it's identified basically in tandem to those two projects.
And I will ask if anybody has any more comments, or Director CAO Smith.
I actually, Chair Mink, I'll wait until everyone has spoken, but before direction, I'd like to make a comment.
Okay, any other comments, or does anybody have anything to say to Deputy Mayor Andrews' point? Mayor Sanderson?
Question for Jeanette. So we negotiated as a municipality with Cameco to put a road in, you know, and that was a tough battle. And now we want to reverse that at their request, and we have to accommodate. We don't have to accommodate. We're accommodating that request, and certainly trying to make sure that the municipality, you know, isn't, you know, after putting all the time and resources and negotiation with you know, infrastructure, et cetera, that we're not at a disadvantage. So my question specifically is, in this land coming forward, being returned to the municipality, is that a requirement? I mean, could Cameco just say, listen, you know, we really do need it all? I mean, how did this sort of come about? Because I'm going to go back to the final result is from a perspective of most people, I think, this is a better outcome than putting the road in. And we're negotiating with them to, you know, mutually not put the road in. And so they've, how did the land transfer come back at this amount? It seemed to me that you said perhaps they may need some of it for their future plans, which is great. And the part that they don't need, they're saying they'll transfer back to the municipality. And in addition, they're still, I think, living up to a commitment of some of the infrastructure requirements that are there, and also protecting some of the environment and the water plant, which is very important. And the part that the tanks are under and that were under special circumstances, is that under the municipal land or is that under the Cameco property? I think it's the municipal.
Oh. Maybe answer that in different parts. So with respect to the special circumstance, there are three tanks. One has always been a municipal tank and will always be a municipal tank. The other two were proposed to be, were Cameco's, and CNL has arranged with a special circumstance with Cameco for those two reservoirs, which will now become municipal. The land transfer, I mean, we could go back to Cameco and say we want the entire parcel. There is no obligation for them to provide any land back to the municipality. The agreement was we would transfer the land. They did pay fair market value at the time for that land, and they were to build the road. Now they have not, they do not want to move forward with the road, as well as a, you know, a great number of the community does not want us to move forward with the road. So it is a compromise. It has been negotiated. They do not need to give us back any portion of the land. So it is potential for us to not gain anything.
Okay, thank you.
And Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Okay, so if we don't get the land back, then the all the tanks are now their responsibility again, because it'll all end up be their land. And the line of the letter of credit, we would not give back.
I believe two of the tanks belong to on their current property, and one is the larger one is a municipal reservoir.
So they take the responsibility for two of them. We'd have one.
Sure. And CAO Smith.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. So I'm reflecting on all of the conversation. I'd like to recommend that this gets referred back to staff. We'll go back to Cameco. We'll ask them about the covenant, the restrictive covenant, and see what they say. We'll also ask them about purchasing or leasing back the land, and then we'll have a definitive answer. Everything else is just speculation, and I think we shouldn't be speculating. And when we have a definitive answer from them, we'll circle back. And we'll be, I can't predict how long that will take. Hopefully they'll be able to advance that fairly quickly. So my suggestion, Chair, is that this matter be referred back to staff.
Okay. Do we have, I assume I need to get a mover to refer this back to staff? And that will be Deputy Mayor Andrews, and a seconder, Councillor Meadows. And I'll ask the vote. All in favor of referring this back to staff? And that is everybody. Okay, so moving along, 9.1.2 report WE-02-22, re traffic and parking bylaw amendment, speed reduction measures. The recommendation that a bylaw be presented to council to amend the traffic and parking bylaw 39/2008 to include the proposed changes as outlined in the attachment of this report, and further that a notice of the proposed changes to the traffic and parking bylaw be posted on the municipal website and community pages of Northumberland News. Could I have a mover and a seconder for this one, please? Moved by Councillor Meadows, seconded by Councillor Carr. And Director Davison, would you like to speak to this for a minute?
Excuse me. The municipality is responsible for providing a safe roadside environment for all users, and speeding is becoming a greater concern within the community. Works and Engineering has undertaken a number of programs in the past, and we continue to evaluate road safety in conjunction with provincial legislation. As part of a recent review, a number of speed reductions are being proposed. They are primarily focused in school zones and within the downtown core, as well as a few locations in the rural area. There are also parking restrictions in proximity to the waterfront on Mill Street, King Street, and Madison Street to address existing concerns related to traffic congestion and emergency access. It's also proposed that there will be an anti-speeding awareness campaign launched later this year as an educational component as part on our website and social media.
Thank you. And is there any discussion? Councillor Carr?
I just wanted to say it was a great report. I learned a lot from it, and it was well written and very concise. And I thank you for that, because it was really, really well done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Mayor Sanderson.
I just want to reiterate what Councillor Carr said and just maybe add a little bit to that. It's very thorough. And I specifically went and looked at these areas, And certainly around the crosswalks and some of the other areas, you know, I think the challenge will be, and I'm glad to hear there's going to be an educational component, because it's really hard to slow traffic down, you know, certainly on some of the ones we've identified. So kudos. And if we can get some photo radar in here before too long, I'd be pleased to support that if it ever came forward. But I concur, excellent report, very detailed, you know, and very thoughtful as to where, you know, the implementation of, you know, traffic calming measure are to be implemented. And I look forward to giving you any support that we can to make that happen. So thank you.
Thank you. And so my comment on this is I agree with the comments so far, and I think it's an excellent report. I continue to get a lot of feedback about traffic as well as pedestrian safety. We had, I'm not sure if everybody's aware, but we did have the OPP created a great video on pedestrian safety, specifically for the rural area in winter, but it applies everywhere. And I really think that having more visibility from a municipal point of view, as far as road safety from both vehicular and pedestrian, is something that we really need to put at the forefront. So this is a great start by doing that. Is there any other comments from council? So I will call the vote. All in favor? And that is unanimous. And so moving on to 9.1.3, report WE-02-22, PHAI information update, Lions Recreation Center, 21 Thomas Street. This is being recommended to be received for information, and I believe the CAO is going to speak to this.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair Mick. This report is for council and public awareness and builds on our ongoing commitment to bring items to council and the community related to PHAI more regularly. As part of the agreement with Canada, there was an agreement to clean up or remediate legacy industrial wastes to the benefit of Port Hope residents and businesses. In some cases, these sites also include some level of low-level radioactive waste, as is the case on this site. This site is scheduled to be remediated subject to MECP approval later this year. Unfortunately, due to the widespread distribution of industrial waste, an extensive remediation is required. This will result in the removal and replacement of many trees. At the request of Municipality of Port Hope staff, CNL developed alternate options for consideration, and after review, all parties agreed to achieve the desired goal and agreed upon outcomes in our agreement. The removal of the trees are required, with a replanting program to start shortly after the hazardous industrial waste is removed. That plan is still under development and as property owners is subject to our approval. Cleaning up industrial sites is a high priority for the PHAI project and one of the municipality of and is one that the municipality of Port Hope invested significant energy and resources in including as part of the overall project, saving us potentially millions of dollars in future remediation costs. As the remediation plan is finalized, more information will be available. Thank you.
Thank you. And so to bring it for discussion, could I have a mover and a seconder, please? And that's moved by Mayor Sanderson, seconded by Councillor Meadows. Is there any discussion or questions about this? Councillor Meadows.
Yes, Director Jeanette Davidson, sorry. I had a mind block there. My concern with this, and I don't even know if you can help answer it, but I'm hoping at least you could take it under consideration, is at the base of Thomas Street where it enters into the Lions Center parking lot, it's both historical and low level in that one area. So I'm sure there's going to be a lot of work to be done in that spot. However, there are three residences and two apartment buildings that in the winter time, over the winter between 22 and 23, when this is being worked on, that is their only access in or out of their properties. As you know, you can't get up Thomas Street sometimes. I mean, it's usually first thing in the morning when everybody's going to work or taking their kids to school. And then the town does a great job on it. And I have to thank you for how well you do look after it. But there, you know how steep it is. And that really is our only access at a lot of times over the winter months. So I'm really hoping that they will take into consideration at least having some way that it's constantly kept open through that time.
Thank you. Any other questions or concerns? Deputy Mayor Andrews.
Yeah, it's one of these that you never win on. Nobody wants to see the trees go, but if it's going to be leaching and leaking for the next 100 years, we're going to have to face a problem sometime in the future and clean it up, and maybe it'd have to be at our expense then. I don't like the solution. I wish there was another one, but I don't think there appears to be one.
And Mayor Sanderson?
I'm going to follow up with a similar comment, and I appreciate that the working relationship between the municipality and CNL and AECL is strong enough that serious efforts were made at looking at all alternatives. But one of the things we as a municipality are benefiting from is the industrial cleanup. And that's a pretty heavy area. And I think if it's not done now and not done properly, you know, we'll be paying in the future for that sort of decision. And the comments of committee member Meadows and the deputy mayor, I think concisely put it together. I think CNL is doing a very good job of ensuring that comments such as keeping the road open, looking after residents are being done. And it is unfortunate. It's unfortunate we have so much industrial waste. It's unfortunate that we have to, see that fixed up, but it would cost, as the CAO said, millions of dollars for the municipality liability to look after this. And this is one of the key areas. So kudos for really all parties looking at all the alternatives and coming forward with what I think is the correct recommendation.
Thank you. And any other comments from council or questions? And this is being received for information, so I will call the vote. All in favor? And that is unanimous. Is there any other, 9.2, new business? I have none. Is there any other questions or comments from Council for Works and Engineering? No, so Works and Engineering is closed, and I will pass it over to Councillor Bickel.
Thank you, Councillor Mix. Part of the emergency service is open. 10.1 staff reports. One fire emergency services report -02-22 remobile parking application. I see we have our CBO with us tonight. Steve, would you like to speak on this?
Yes. Good evening, and thank you, Councillor Bickels. What we're looking at right now is this is a new app that would allow for a coinless operation of all parking in the municipality of Port Hope. So it is it's been an ongoing, I would say, for probably about 2 years now that we've been looking at an alternative to coin only operation of our parking meters. And with this new system, it gives us the opportunity to allow that to the public for a more friendly way of coming to our community and allowing to be parking with not going into your pockets and looking for coin, for lack of a better term. I'm not sure what else to say about that, to be honest with you.
That's fine, Steve. I was just told you were the expert on it when Dan told me I was going on holidays, so...
I would be happy to answer any questions for any counselor, whatever, if they have any questions about this, how the system is going to work. I'll be happy to do it.
Okay. Any questions from any members to council? Mayor Sanderson?
Just want to compliment this advancement moving forward. Parking has been a discussion, never mind 2 years, Steve. It's been going on a lot longer than that. And I think with everywhere we look, technology is starting to be an impact, you know, on mobile devices. And so many communities you go to now, you can put the app on and you can go and, you know, do your shopping. And if it's running late, you move forward. And I see it as a very good and very exciting first step in starting to manage parking in the municipality. So really appreciate, I know this has been a discussion point and work in progress for a while. And pass it on to Dan as well, because I know he's been working on it hard as well. So great to hear. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor May.
Thank you. I just want to agree with that more people are becoming more used to using this type of technology, but I also appreciate that there will still be an option for coins. I think that's still important that there is the transition, because some people don't have access to mobile devices, and I think we need to support both. So I think it's a great start to what's next.
Okay. Deputy Mayor Anders?
Yeah. Hand up. Yep, Steve, will we be doing anything with our hours of operation? Are we looking at weekends enforcement, or are we going to just leave it Monday through Friday?
At this point, we are looking into expanding at the hours of operation, especially in the summer season, with the activity that is going down, especially at the boat launch, the beach area, all along that area. But right now, it is in discussion stages. We have to look at staffing levels at this point in time and what we're able and capable to do at this point.
Thank you.
Any other questions from anybody? Well, Mayor Sanderson.
Just a comment. We know that parking is a source of revenues in some cases, but going forward, we're going to have to make some significant investments, I believe, in parking, you know, overall. And so I think we do need to look at revenues to generate that. So it's not coming out of, you know, other kind of revenues. Parking revenues should, in my opinion, support, you know, parking improvements. And I think this is a good step forward. And it's far more efficient. And I agree with Councillor Make. There always just needs to be a transition. And I think we're doing that here. So great.
And there is actually, there's no cost to the municipality for setting this up at this point in time. It is covered under what we're currently purchasing now for our new parking authority, I guess you would call it, Steve. I'm not sure just what you would call it, but it's part of that whole process, which is enables us to set this up and get it going, which do think it's going to be a great plus for the municipality. It's going to save a lot of time sitting and counting coins. I know staff spends a lot of time sitting counting nickels and dimes, so it'll relieve some of that pressure on staff and allow our staff to be out doing other things. So it's going to be a win-win situation for the municipality, I think, in a whole. And like everything else, it's going to take some training to get the members of the municipality to get used to the idea that this is what we're doing now and they can do it. But the younger generation, I think, will just jump right onto it, no problem. And the senior citizens may take a little longer to come around, but a lot more seniors are getting more tax savvy all the time. So I'm sure they'll catch on as well. So thanks, Steve, for your knowledge that you do have on it, and we can always question Dan later on down the road if the need be. So thank you very much. Well, we'll receive it for information. Do I need a mover and a seconder for this? Okay, looking for a mover. Councillor Meadows, and a seconder. Councillor Carr, all in favor? Okay, that's carried. All right, moving on to 10.2, new business. The only thing I have for under new business is with the weather getting nicer, especially this week, we could see some mid to high teens near the end of the week for a day or so, but it is March break, and kids have been cooped up for 2 years. They're going to be out the next few days in full force, I would imagine. So if you're out driving, just take care that kids could be out riding their bikes, playing on the streets. They've been cooped up all winter, and some of them may have forgotten how to act around roadways and watch out for cars. So just a reminder to everybody to take that little extra vigilance and make sure that if there are kids in the area, and you keep an eye on them and know where they are, because they can move quick, and sometimes they end up in places where they shouldn't be. So just a reminder to everybody to have an eye and keep an eye out. And like I say, the weather is getting nicer, so it's not just the kids that'll be out and about. Adults are going to be out walking. If you come across giant puddles on the roadway, slow down, because going through a puddle at 40 or 50 k an hour can send water back 20 or 30 feet onto sidewalks where pedestrians are walking. And I don't know how many people have actually had a bath from passing cars early in the spring, but it's not a nice feeling to have to end up your walk home soaking wet. So just a little reminder to have a little bit of care and respect people that are out walking. So is it for that. If there's any questions for our emergency services, take them now.
Okay. We'll open up generally for any questions from committee members for anything that was on this evening's discussions. And I'll ask the clerk to check with our public and with any media that should be requesting attendance and any questions and or comments.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As you note, the instructions to pose a question are posted with today's agenda. We still do have some attendees on the line. If you're listening in and have a question for council, please indicate, yeah, you do, by raising your digital hand. We will unmute you and you can pose your question to council. No indication of any questions tonight, Mr. Mayor.
Well, thank you very much. And I want to thank staff for some excellent reports and council for all the debate we had and for the participants who are listening in. And with that, I'd like to have a mover and a seconder to adjourn the Committee of the Whole. Moved by Councillor Meadows. Second, please. Councillor Bickle, all those in favor? Thank you. Good evening. Have a safe evening, and we'll chat soon. Take care.
Good night, everyone.